All right. So we're going to go ahead and get started. This is the first ever Millennials Mayor Forum that's happening in Pasadena. My name is Nicole Bernard, and I currently serve as third vice president for Pasadena NAACP. I want to go ahead and thank you guys for joining us this evening. For us as young leaders, young and up and coming leaders, we felt it was important to really give an opportunity for those who are like us to have the platform to be able to ask questions from a millennial's perspective. So I'm going to go ahead and introduce our sponsor organizations for tonight. We have NAACP Pasadena, Hood Liberation, which is an up-and-coming millennial organization in the Pasadena community. And we also have Pasadena Young Leaders, which is another, it's a collective of Black and Brown millennial leaders in the Pasadena area. So I'm going to go ahead and let Jose Madeira, who's also going to be co-hosting this evening, introduce himself, and then he will give you guys a rundown of the rules and the agenda for tonight. Go ahead, Jose.
Hello, everyone. Again, also I want to thank everyone for being here. My name is Jose Madeira, from Pasadena, born and raised in Northwest Pasadena, a former PUSD student, and currently work and live in Pasadena. And before we go to the rundown, we want to highlight that this is a Black and Brown millennial organized event by people who live or born, live, and work in Pasadena. We want to highlight the Black and Brown unity in Pasadena within our communities. We have similar struggles and trauma, and throughout history, there have been many moments where we stand in solidarity with each other. During those times of solidarity, we see much political, social, and economic change in our communities. And today we're here to voice the concerns of Black and Brown millennials and to inform our community of the upcoming elections and who might lead our city government. So again, we thank everyone for being here. So a rundown of the debate is, at first, we're gonna have the two candidates give a 2-minute introduction. And then me and Nicole will be asking the questions. After each question is asked, each candidate will have 2 minutes to respond. And then there will also be a 1-minute rebuttal. The yes and no questions do not require additional explanation. And we ask the two candidates to be respectful, to answer the questions thoroughly and direct as you can.
Just really quick, I also wanted to remind people that this is being live streamed on our social media, and it also will be on KPAS and I believe Arroyo Media.
Yes. Great. So just want to make sure we have both candidates here. Yes, we do. All right. So now we will start our debate. So first we have again, the opening remarks from both mayoral candidates. So we'll go first with Mayor Tornick.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Thanks to the sponsors and thanks to the viewers for taking time out to participate in this. The pandemic, as we know, has damaged everyone, but I think it's been most hurtful to young people among the various categories. In every area of activity, whether it's school or job hunting or career building or social lives, I think young people have been terribly impacted. And I've been Zooming mostly with young people every week and hearing the challenges that you specifically face. There was a PUSD event that was actually an in-person socially distanced event last week over at McKinley, hearing from young people about the challenges that the high school people were facing. And yet the reality is that we all still have to carry on in the face of everything that's confronting us. And that's true for city government as well. And I think that in spite of the extraordinary combination of challenges that the city of Pasadena has been confronted with, we have to continue to deliver service to the people of the city. And not just the customary services, but we've had to move into some areas that we typically are not so deeply engaged in. And I think we've performed well. And I think I've done my part as mayor in that performance. But the judgment of performance can't just be on how we performed during the months of the pandemic. It has to be what's happened over the years of service. And I think that if you look at what I pledged to do when I ran for office 5 years ago, I think I've delivered on the things that I promised, including making Pasadena financially strong, supporting the school district, safeguarding the environment, protecting the quality of life in the neighborhoods, and reducing crime. We're going to have very serious challenges going forward. And I think that helping families, restoring business activity, adjusting the way we do business, all of these are going to require the leadership that I think I've demonstrated. And I hope that I'll have an opportunity to gain your support in seeking to continue my role as mayor. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you, Mayor Tornik. So now we have Councilmember Borderlin.
Thank you, everyone, for joining us and for giving me this opportunity. You know, I was honored to have the support of many of you in the primary and humbly honored to finish first. And I thank you for that and the trust and confidence that meant. You know, as I think through COVID and I think through leadership, and I think through even before COVID, I think you've seen a difference in approach and leadership. And I am worried about the millennial generation, 25 to 45 year olds approximately. And, you know, I sometimes think, boy, what a generation to grow up in. In so many ways, the challenges that you face, you graduate from college during a recession. You know, this is the most diverse generation that we've seen in America. The 09, in year 09, you start building credit and the housing market and the recession hit. You face stagnant wages for the most difficult time to come out of college and to be growing up. You know, I look at the savings to debt ratio, and that's something that concerns me for this generation. I look at the recession and then COVID and what we're facing and what your generation in particular is facing, and that concerns me. One in four of you lost jobs. This is the generation that's been greatest hit by the crisis. Credit relief. This is the generation that has had to apply most for credit relief. And there's a reason for that. The smallest cushion going into the COVID, into the recession, was among this generation. And so, you know, then we start to look at the strata within your generation, the, you know, women, people of color, African Americans, Latinos, and not just what you face, but what your generation will face in lasting impacts after all of these experiences, the mental health issues. All of the issues that face society in general are highly, highly exposed for everyone, but they've really come under the microscope for you. And so as your mayor, I'm going to continue to bring people together to address those issues, not just
thank you,
in general, but for all of us.
Thank you, Council Member Gordo. So again, we want to remind we're going to have 2 minutes. Something that we wanted to mention too, we are going to give a 30 second to let you know that you have 30 seconds in your 2 minutes for each question. So reminder.
How are you going to let us know that? I can't. Someone's holding up a note, it looks like, but I can't see it.
I'll say it out loud.
Okay.
Because we're on Zoom. I think probably the best way is just to say it out loud. So Mia and Nicole, again, are going to let you know. So we can start with our debate. So again, me and Nicole will ask each question. Each candidate has 2 minutes to answer and with a 1 minute rebuttal. All right, so the first question is, what are your plans to improve the partnership between the city of Pasadena and the NPUSD to ensure our public schools receive the financial support where as possible? An example, in addition to the measure I and J. So we'll go first with Mayor Turner.
Thank you. I discovered early on that the relationship between the city and the PUSD needed some strengthening. I learned that in my years as a planning director. And traditionally, there's real separation between the city and the school district. I guess it's because they each have their own elected bodies, but I never really understood it. Where I grew up back east, the school district was part of the city government, and the school superintendent was part of was another department head, like the public works superintendent. So it was alien to me, and I never really thought it made any sense. And it was confirmed to me when I did my first campaign to the city council that people in the city all wanted the school district to be supported and to be improved. And that was true whether they had kids in the system or not. So I set about trying to build a closer relationship, and I was appointed to a new entity called Collaborate Pasadena about 6 years ago, which was a joint effort by the district and the city to work for the kids. And based on the work and the conversations I had with school board members and the superintendent and staff, I conceived of the idea of Measure J, which you've referenced, which delivers $7 million a year to the school district. And I've continued to have a series of meetings and have had several city council members meeting on an ad hoc basis with their peers, school board members, to discover ways that we can work together to continue to support the school district, both financially and operationally, through the library, through the programs that the Recs department runs, and a whole variety of ways. This is a central part of what I've focused on as mayor.
Thank you, Mayor Turnick. Now we have Councilmember Gordo.
When I think about our schools and I talk about our schools, I'm passionate about it, and because of the kids there and the opportunity that education represents. I know that, I started out as a Spanish-speaking monolingual student in the Pasadena Unified School District, and I know the value of education. And I know the value of education in Pasadena and as it brought it to my family. And so when I think about our schools, it's because I attended those schools. When I think about the kids who are struggling, it's because I was one of those kids. I supported Measure I and J. Mayor Tornik will tell you that when people wouldn't collaborate and give money towards that, I quietly went and raised money for Measure I and J. I would save you the bulk of the money, but I didn't run around taking credit for it. I didn't say this was my idea. This was, my effort. I did it because it was the right thing to do. And I did it because I know the kids in our district deserve the opportunity, a fair opportunity, to be successful in contributing members of our community. And that's going to happen through education. And I'm going to continue to do that. I've asked a number of times that we take it a step further, not just have meetings and talk about partnerships, but I've asked the city council and Mayor Tornik some time ago, let's put on the agenda the issue of Wi-Fi. 30 seconds. My wife is a school teacher, and I see how she struggles with her kids and her students on the issue of connectivity. Why that discussion has not been scheduled, you'll have to ask Mayor Tornik. But I think we should jump in and partner with the school district to ensure that kids in our district don't just have a school and an education, but that they have real access to education. And I think there's an opportunity there for citywide partnership, and that includes Wi-Fi and connectivity.
Thank you, Councilmember Gordo. Thank you very much. I heard also a question for Mayor Tornik, if you want to.
Yeah, I would point out that while I did not attend Pasadena Public Schools, I went to school in Brooklyn. My children and my grandchildren have attended and are currently attending Pasadena Public Schools. My wife was a teacher in the Pasadena Unified School District. My son is a teacher at Marshall. So we are a public school, Pasadena Public School family. As to Wi-Fi connectivity, we've had several discussions at the council level and presentations on connectivity. We provide it at the libraries, we provide it in the parks. We do not have a citywide Wi-Fi system, and Councilmember Gordo should remember the presentations we've had on that.
Councilmember Gordo, would you like to respond?
Yeah, no, it goes further than presentations. It goes further, and there have not been robust discussions. It means sitting down, Mayor Tornik, as you know, sitting down and talking. And I've asked for it to be agendized. I've asked for it to be agendized during our budget discussions. I've asked for it to be agendized so we can actually make some progress on it. And you know, it's an important issue. It's not just at libraries. It's not just at schools. Given what's going on right now, it's in our neighborhoods, and we ought to be partnering. We ought to be partnering together, but not just with the school district, with PCC, and maybe some of the universities like Art Center and Cal and Caltech. And I think we can do better. And I think we should do better. I think we have a responsibility to do better.
Thank you, Council Member Gordo. So next question, also with the PUSD. It's a yes or no question. It's, do you support the bond measure O? Yes or no? And we'll go with Mayor Tornik.
Sorry, yes.
Yes. Thank you. Councilmember Gordo?
Yes.
Next, Nicole.
So thank you guys. So the next question is, what are your plans to offer more resources to youth? Sometimes when programs are created, certain youth are excluded because of varying factors such as GPA. So this question will go first to Gordo.
I'm sorry, Nicole, you broke up. Can you repeat the question?
Yes. So the question is, what are your plans to offer more resources to youth? Sometimes when programs are created, certain youth are excluded because of varying factors such as GPA. So it's gonna go first to Gordo and then to Tornik.
So, you know, this is an issue that's near and dear to my heart. An issue I've worked on for a long time, since I was a young person myself in my early 20s working at the Day One Community Partnership, bringing together over 300 organizations to provide alternative activities for kids during the summer. It was called Youth Month, and I'm very proud of that. And you know, I've worked on that since the early 90s, and I've worked on it for a reason. You know, I think bringing programs that cause kids to be inquisitive and develop skills like in metal shops and art shops and wood shops, something that is lacking now, helps them find different paths to success. And I saw that when I was in high school, at Pasadena High School, and those programs and the kids who were involved in the metal shop or, you know, with electricity are now linesmen, people that I went to high school in the city of Pasadena, plumbers, and they're making a great living and elsewhere. And so I'm very committed to bringing those programs back with partners in labor who are anxious for more qualified workers who they can put to work. And you know, recently, but it's not just it's not just school age kids, it's pre-school age, 0 to 5, 0 to 3 are the most formative years. And I pressed for Pasadena to be an early learning city. I pressed very hard, and Mayor Tornik will tell you, to create the Office of the Young Child to connect families with early childhood education so kids can be from a young age interested and inquisitive as they develop. And Mayor Tornik will tell you, it took me 2 years to fund one full-time position for that program. And I would say to you that I did not find a partner in Mayor Tornik to create that position. It took 1 year, the council funded half a position to connect kids and families with early childhood education in our community. And then the second year.
Sorry, go ahead, Mayor Tornik.
Thank you. I'm pretty familiar with the youth programs as well, or many of them. My son ran the Villa Park summer program for a number of years, so I had direct exposure there. We just reorganized the city in terms of the how we deliver youth program services. We changed the Parks and Recreation Department in a way that I think will be able to do a more effective job in terms of delivering youth programs. The reference that you made, Nicole, to a GPA requirement and programming is news to me, honestly. I don't know about that, but I'm certainly going to find out. I honestly, I don't know about that, so I can't comment on it. but I will investigate it because it puzzles me. I don't understand it. But I have spent a lot of time in Collaborate Pasadena and in later discussions, meeting with the school district and our Parks and Rec people in terms of coordinating the services that they provide. Each of them provide after-school programs, for example. And we spent a lot of time trying to rationalize those programs to make sure we're doing the most effective job that we can. With regard to 0 to 5, Councilmember Gordo deserves a lot of credit for his emphasis on introducing that program. And I'm proud of what they've been able to achieve. It's housed in the library department, which I think is an innovative place to put it. And they've just been in the process of hiring a new director for it.
Thank you. And just really quick, the question also, when we came up with the question, it was towards the ambassador program. I know currently you need either a 2.0 or a 2.5 in order to participate. And I believe the same is true for the Pasadena, I forgot the young program, but it's basically, I'll come back to you. Did you want a rebuttal, Gordo?
Yeah, you know, so the GPA issue has been around since I was in high school. And we're just repeating mistakes of the past. I recall being a high school student when some of my teammates were disqualified from participating on school teams because their grades dipped. Instead of encouraging them, instead of providing the after-school counseling that some of my colleagues needed, and I needed too, frankly, instead of doing that, we shut the door on them. And I can tell you that was wrong. And so if we're repeating that mistake, we ought to correct it.
Thank you. And just really quick, the other program I was referring to is Pasadena Youth Council.
Yeah.
Tornick, did you want a rebuttal?
No.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right, thank you again. So something that we want to do quickly is, so I'm going to hold, instead of interrupting, I'm going to hold a 30-second sign. So please look at my camera and when you have 30 seconds. Okay, thank you very much. So the next question is, the cost of housing is at a crux for many of the issues that millennials are facing today, whether it be delaying starting a family, paying off college loans, racial or class inequality, public schools closures, or just being able to afford to live in a middle-class life in the community you grew up. Neither of you supported rent control or the city's newly allocated RHNA numbers, which is the Regional Housing Needs Assessment. What solutions would you offer as mayor to address the cost of housing and the effects it is having on millennials? So we'll go first with Councilmember, Mayor Turnick, and then Councilmember Gordo.
Thank you. I absolutely agree that the cost of housing, not just in Pasadena, but throughout Southern California, has become a tremendous issue for so many people, particularly millennials, but really for people all up and down the age groups. The reason that I don't support rent control is because rent control suppresses the production of new housing. You can't regulate your way out of the housing shortage. You have to build additional housing. And if you impose rent control, it discourages investment in new housing. It also, based on my personal experience, discourages property owners from investing in existing housing and maintaining it in good condition. So while it sounds like a great idea and an obvious idea, and it certainly provides protection for people who happen to be living in a unit when it passes, in the long term, it's been pretty clearly established that rent control does not produce additional housing resources and it makes the problem worse. The RHNA discussion, the RHNA that you raised, is a question of numbers that Pasadena is supposed to hit in terms of production or pay penalties in a variety of losing local control. And the problem with the RHNA numbers and the reason that we reacted so strongly to it is because the RHNA numbers that have been suggested for Pasadena are completely unachievable. And the result is, it's not a matter of being aspirational and trying to set a target that we'd like to hit. It's really a matter of making the numbers so high that it's literally unachievable, and it stimulates a backlash against the whole process, which is not productive. So we need to get to a place where we continue to do some of the positive things we've been doing: inclusionary housing, building on city property, working with the churches to build on their property, working with the school district to try to build housing on their property, We need to build additional housing and make sure affordable housing is part of that new production.
Mayor Turnick, Councilmember Gordo.
Yeah, the cost of housing is both for rent and for home ownership is out of control. That's why I've dedicated so much time and effort to it, replacing liquor stores with affordable housing, burnt out apartment buildings with affordable housing. In my district, we've constructed the most affordable housing, and I'm very proud of that. And it's taken a lot of effort and a lot of working together with residents, building consensus on the city council to give direction to the city staff to do that. And I'm very proud of that. The rent control issue, I agree that, look at Los Angeles, look at Santa Monica, look at San Francisco, who all have rent control and regrettably are some of the most expensive rent markets and for sale markets in the entire country, certainly in the state, and they have rent control. The RENA numbers are not achievable. And so the question is, what do we do? Well, in 2006, before Mayor Tornik joined the city council, I pressed for the inclusionary housing ordinance to set aside 15% of all development to be affordable. I pressed for that together with my colleagues on the city council. We achieved it when Pasadena led. Pasadena is not going to construct its way out of the housing market. It's not a Pasadena problem. It's a regional and state and national problem. And we know that, mostly state and regional. And so we need to be working with our neighbors. I had to chuckle a little bit after the first debate when Mayor Tornik said, the San Gabriel Valley Council of Governments is not working on housing, is not working on the issues that Pasadena cares about. They're not relevant. And there are 31 cities in the San Gabriel Valley who work together on housing, homelessness, water issues. And one city is missing, city of Pasadena, because Mayor Tara Tornik insisted that we leave our partners. And when asked at a housing forum, why aren't we working with our neighbors to bring more housing, affordable housing to the region? When asked, why aren't we working with our neighbors? This is what he said. He says, those cities are smaller than us. They're not relevant. I reject that argument. The Council of Government is not going to solve our problems, but it's an important tool that can benefit the people of Pasadena and the region. And who walks away from a tool like that? An important tool and our neighbors and friends who are working together, but we're not there. And we need to change that too.
Thank you, Council Member Cordo. Mayor Terry Turnick, would you like to
report? This issue about the Council of Governments is a red herring. The reason I don't want to join forces with them is not because they're smaller, but because they've typically opposed progressive housing programs, and I don't want to be affiliated with them. I wasn't on the council in 2006, but I was on Pasadena Neighborhood Housing Services Board from 1982 to the year 2000, which was the primary housing, affordable housing producer in Northwest Pasadena. And I have been a volunteer in producing affordable housing, both in Pasadena and statewide, for most of my adult life. So my record in terms of being an advocate and an actual producer of affordable housing is I think, unequal.
I would invite everyone to go to to look at the Star News article on the election, recent election, of the president of the Council of Governments, Margaret, I think it's Clark from Rosemead. And she'll tell you that article in very concise, the Council of Governments is working on affordable housing. They put together a housing trust. They're working on water. They're working on all of the issues that affect us, and they're doing it together. And Pasadena is not only missing out, but not at the table. That's wrong. This is a city of leaders, and we should be leading for the benefit of all Pasadenans, but yes, also to be good neighbors. And one other point, when we say those cities are not relevant, remember those people, over 2 million people, 2.2, 2.4 million people will know in the next census. They're the people who come visit our city and our businesses rely on as well. We can't be that dismissive, and we shouldn't be. It's not consistent with our city's values at all.
Thank you. One of the sense in the community is that I know both of you spoke about affordable housing, One of the sense is that the people who need that affordable housing are not the ones who are getting the affordable housing because of some loopholes. And then with that, the next question is, gentrification has impacted many cities all over LA County. What will you do to combat gentrification and the displacement of Black and Brown people in Northwest Pasadena? And we'll start with Councilmember Gordo.
You know, this is gentrification is an issue that has faced Pasadena and our region for quite some time. And, you know, it's a complicated issue. And this is why, you know, when someone is selling their house, do you go to them and say, don't sell, or their property? Or do you go to the buyer and say, don't buy? And, you know, the honest reality is we can't do either. But what we can do is build on our efforts on inclusionary housing, being smart about developing new affordable housing. And importantly, it ties back to opportunity. You know, it ties back to education and ensuring that people have the opportunity to be successful and contributing members of our community. And so what am I going to do? I'm going to work with my colleagues. I'm going to work with my colleagues on the city council, every one of them, with Vice Mayor Tyrone Hampton, who's endorsed me, Steve Madison, who's endorsed me, incoming Councilwoman Felicia Williams, who's endorsed me, and every other member of the city council, as I have for 20 years. And I'm going to listen carefully to everyone in this community. You know, it's not just about preparation to address issues as complicated as the displacement and gentrification of people is very complicated, and it's going to take all of us working together, and I'm going to do that as I have by listening, being prepared as I have, and including all of the voices on the city council and in our community. That's real preparation, is reading the reports, yes, but, you know, not coming in with a pre-baked idea and then saying this is where we're going. It means being prepared and listening to people and being prepared to adjust maybe your own views coming into the meeting. And that's how we're going to address gentrification together.
Mayor Turnick.
Gentrification is a serious issue. It's particularly serious in Councilmember Gordo's district. And I think that some of his most aggressive supporters are people who are realtors and brokers who are in fact making a living at gentrification. There's nothing inappropriate about that. They need to make a living, and buying houses and improving them and then flipping them is a well-established tradition in Northwest Pasadena. The way to deal with that is to produce additional housing that people can afford. And that's what we need to focus on. There's been a lot of discussion about concentration of affordable housing, and some on the council, including Councilmember Gordo, have said that we've been building too much affordable housing in Northwest Pasadena. I disagree with that. That's where the need is, and that's where we should be doing it. And the kinds of affordable housing that we're building now are not the big concentration of big projects which concentrate low-income households. They're much smaller projects. They fit with the neighborhood. They don't have an adverse impact. They have a positive impact. And so I think we need to alter that strategy, and I think we need to build as much affordable housing in Northwest as we can. And I think we then also need to focus on the ability to market that housing to people who are living in Pasadena or have lived in Pasadena. I have people coming to me and telling me they've lived in Pasadena for three generations and they can't afford to live here anymore. The way to deal with that is to give them housing opportunities, also to expand the Section 8 program, which we've continued to try to do with the federal government with no success. If we have a change in administration in Washington next month, we may have more opportunities there. That's the single most impactful program we have for affordable housing in Pasadena.
Councilmember Gordo, would you like to rebuttal?
Yeah, it's kind of funny to hear someone who spent their career as a developer and developing property and now is supported by developers, be critical of my supporters. My supporters come from every walk of life. My supporters come from every part of the city, not, you know, from a very focused community of developers. You know, I've never said there was too much affordable housing in Northwest Pasadena, or and we should stop. What I've said is, you know, the people that people deserve to live in every part of this city, and that people, you know, shouldn't be relegated to any one part of the city. There's this, there's sometimes, you know, I was on up on the ocean with my son Michael on a boat when somebody said to me, "Oh, what part of Pasadena are you from?" I know what they're saying. And let me tell you something. When I say, let's stick to the inclusionary housing ordinance and allow affordable housing to be built naturally with other development, that's what I mean. You know, I rejected the project.
Councilmember Gordon, minute up. Mayor Tornik, would you like to rebuttal?
Yeah, I agree that there should be affordable housing in every district in the city. And that's why I was so disappointed when one of the largest affordable housing opportunities that's come to the city at the Space Bank project in East Pasadena, which would have created 69 units of affordable housing, about $35 million worth of affordable housing, was opposed by Councilmember Gordo. I think that we need to have affordable housing all over the city. I have had development experience. I do understand how this works. And I further understand that we need to be creative and imaginative and flexible in how we develop affordable housing. And that means bringing all of the tools available to us into play.
Thank you. We got to move on to the next question, which Nicole.
Thank you, guys, Francis. I just also want mention that when we think about housing, it needs to be thought about not just in Northwest Pasadena, but all over Pasadena. And then we also need affordable housings, not just homes. And not to mention that we have people in this city right now that work full-time jobs that aren't working minimum wage, that cannot afford to even rent in this city. So I just want to, well, rent their own homes. So I just wanted to put that out there. So we're going to move on to the next question. So it reads like this. We acknowledge COVID-19 has impacted the financial health of residents in all zip codes. Recently, the city awarded over $1 million in rent relief. Could you provide us with a breakdown of applicants per district? And what percentage of the grantees were from Northwest Pasadena or Black and Brown? So we're going to go with Tornik first and then Gordo.
I don't have that information. That application process has just been completed. And they were just, I think by now they've awarded most or all the money, but we haven't had a report on at the level of detail that you just suggested. So I don't know the answer to that question.
Yeah, Mayor Tornik is correct. I mean, I believe it's half of the dollars have been allocated, but we've not had a report in any sort of detail. It's likely to come in the near future, but we've not, I too don't know the answer to that because we've not been briefed or received a report.
Thank you. Is there a way that you guys can get back to us with that information once it's available? Thank you.
We can ask that it be posted on the city's website and made public.
Thank you.
And something to mention too, a lot of people in the community did not know about that effort, that rent relief effort. And I think it was even in the council that it was spoken about and how the outreach was not well done for people that needed that support. So the next question that we have.
If I can, I would just say that I think there may be another round on that. And so we welcome those comments and we'll try and do it differently.
Thank you. Councilmember Gordo, do you have anything else to say about it?
No, I agree. If people didn't receive the message, then we should do a better job of that and the feedback would be welcome.
Thank you.
And we'd be happy to work with you guys on that.
Yes. So next question is, as mayor, how do you plan to support undocumented families in our community? We'll first go with Councilmember Gordo.
Yeah, so, you know, I think we should embrace all families and all kids. I myself am an immigrant. I was brought to Pasadena by my parents at age 4. And I've had the great benefit of growing up in a very diverse community. I've had the great benefit of having a lot of people help me out over the years and contribute to my being able to sit before you and ask for your support as mayor. Not something I did alone. And it was, you know, Little League coaches, it was Little League moms, you know, it was high school coaches and teachers and neighbors. When my father was, you know, cooking at Ranchero Restaurant, from which he retired after 50 years, my mother was a seamstress. It was these people who looked out after me. And I think we have a responsibility to do the same for all families, documented or not, because they're our neighbors. They live in our neighborhoods. These families work for us and with us. And I know that. I know that very, very personally, having grown up in a garage in Pasadena, and it's in large part because of that life's experience that I've had right here in this city with the people of this city, that I believe I'm best positioned to be the mayor of this city, because I know this city from every vantage point, from, you know, our neighborhoods and delivering newspapers, waiting on tables in this community, working with people of all walks of life, to the boardrooms of the Rose Bowl and the city council. And that's precisely why I believe I'm best positioned to bring us together as a city and to lead this city.
Thank you, Councilmember Gordo, but also remind me of the question. I know we know your story, we heard your story, but we want to also know, what are you going to be doing as mayor to protect and support the undocumented families in our community?
It's what we have been doing. It's and we need to do more of it. Whether it's helping day laborers or supporting families who need the support, not just in programs. And I'll remind you, having our voice known, I'll remind you.
Councilmember Gordo, so we're going to go to Mayor Turnick to answer his question.
Yeah, it's interesting. I was on a youth panel last week, and the question that was posed to me was, what is the single biggest issue confronting our country? It really wasn't a mayoral question, it was a general question, and I said that immigration reform was the single biggest issue. And as much of a fan as I was of President Obama, I felt that the greatest missed opportunity of his administration was not accomplishing really comprehensive immigration reform when he had a majority in Congress and had the White House at his control. But I think that the city has a well-established record of working with immigrant families. One of the ways we've especially focused on, frankly, in supporting undocumented is making sure that they were counted in the census. Early on, I worked very hard with the city clerk and others in terms of focusing on making sure that we got the census tracts that weren't counted in the past counted, because those dollars come significantly to people from that community. The support to the PUSD is another way that we continue to support undocumented people and other people. Endelon, which Councilmember Gordo referenced, the job center on North Lake Avenue is another critical component of support for that particular community. But I think in general, the issue has to do with how we support people who are in need in general, and not just particularly people who are undocumented. I don't have the biography to talk about that the Councilmember Gordo does, because my immigrant story was a generation earlier. But I'm certainly sympathetic. I understand what immigrants are confronted with. I understand what language barriers mean One of my grandparents lived in this country for 60 years, never learned English, so I know what that's about. But Pasadena is working hard to support all of our families, including the undocumented.
May I rebut?
Yes, go ahead.
So, you know, but Mayor Tornik does have a record on immigration. You'll recall, and I invite you all to look at issues like SB 1070 in Arizona. The Arizona law, I think it was in 2011, that sought to attack immigrants and stigmatize them. And the council took a vote. And it's important for us to make our voices known as a city and as individuals. And I voted and argued to object to 1070, to pay, make this city's voice known that we should not stigmatize anyone. And Mayor Tornik refused that action.
I'm sorry, whoever's on not mute, can you please mute yourself?
Refuse to, you know, this is before the, this is at the, you know, at the birth of the attack on immigrants. And Arizona was doing the wrong thing. And I said Pasadena should speak up, and I spoke up. And I asked my colleagues on the city council to speak up. And it narrowly passed, I think it was 5-3, a bare majority. Mayor Tornik was on the wrong side of that issue. He refused to speak up.
So next, Mayor Tornik, if you would like to rebuttal.
Yeah, that's a cheap shot. Councilmember Gordo knows very well that the reason I refuse to support that is that I feel strongly that Pasadena should not be spending council time on issues that we don't have control over or that we haven't been elected to deal with. And so I objected conceptually and philosophically. I don't vote on foreign policy issues. I don't vote on China, not dealing with the Uyghurs properly. To sort of tar me with that is really unfair. And I had a specific discussion with him about it, which he's forgotten, I guess. And he made the point that he knows that my daughter-in-law is Guatemalan and that I was not a prejudiced person. But he understood what my position was. Now suddenly he's forgotten that conversation and it's become an issue.
It's a question.
And I think everyone understands that we can't vote on like federal, you know, things, but the city wants to know, especially the communities, undocumented communities, what position you are, especially as leaders of Pasadena, so they can feel safe in Pasadena, going to PUSD, going to work, shopping, and living here. So that's what the community wants. So next, we have our next question from Nicole.
So our question is, as mayor, how do you plan to work with the Pasadena Police Department to build engagement between the police department and the community? This question specific examples include communities at Villa Park, La Pinaresca, King's Manor, and the Community Arms. These are all communities of color who don't normally have the best relationship with our local police department. And from my understanding, also has a higher run-in with the police, and it doesn't always end out in the most fortunate situation. So we are going to start with Mayor Tornik and then Councilmember Gordo.
Thank you. The reason that I worked so hard and pushed so hard to get the city to act on some of the suggestions made by, among others, NAACP and Endelon about community oversight is because I recognize that there's a shortfall in terms of the relationship between the PD and some of the communities of color, that the police department is not necessarily trusted as much as it needs to be if it's going to operate successfully and serve all the people of the city. So I took a very aggressive stance. I signed the Obama Pledge, which is something I almost never do, because I felt that we reached such a critical point nationally in this conversation, and that Pasadena had its own history to deal with. And so I felt we had to move fast, and I talked with a bunch of people in the community. My hope is that the community oversight group, this commission that will be appointed in very short order, I hope, will really be a bridge in terms of having people from the community having responsibility on an ongoing basis to interact with the police department, to build the kinds of bridges that the chief that Chief Perez has been trying to build on an informal basis, but in a more institutionalized way, to bring people from communities of color, people from the specific developments that you referenced in terms of at La Pinta and community arms, together with police officers in a non-confrontational environment. And that if people representing these communities have an ongoing relationship with the police department in reviewing their hiring practices, their training, the way that they interact with the community, that can lead to a whole new level of trust that hasn't been able to be developed somehow between the community and the police department. I'm very optimistic about that, and I'm fully committed to following through on that.
Thank you, Councilmember Gordon.
You know, public safety is likely the most sensitive subject that any municipality deals with, because as we've learned and we know, it's because, you know, it can end in force against the very people sought to be protected. And so we have to build that trust. When the issue was front and center a few months ago, instead of building trust and engaging the community, Mayor Tornick and one other council member came back with what they called the Kennedy-Tornick proposal. And you know why I objected? One, because that's not building trust. Cutting out half of the committee and then most of the city council, and importantly, the community out of discussion was wrong. Cuts exactly against the trust we were trying to build. One, and two, what they came back with was no independence. And I said that. I said, this isn't sufficient. We need real independence because we need to build trust. And that's, you know, that's why we ended up where we ended up, not because of any one proposal. We ended up there because I spoke out loudly, and those of you that follow that know that, together with the Vice Mayor Tyrone Hampton. And in terms of communication, you know, I talk with our police officers. And when Jasmine Richard and BLM showed up on my front door, running through my backyard and peering in windows, I stepped outside, and I was called to step outside to, and I asked Jasmine, what are you doing? And you know what she said to me? Victor, we just want to talk. And I stepped out and I said, if that's what you want to do, then let's talk. And there were close to 100 people on my front lawn. I didn't say get off my front lawn. I engaged them. And then they said, you know, after 40 minutes, well, you just finish our conversation as we walk down the street. And I said, I'll do that.
Thank you, Councilmember Gorder.
So just coming home, and I did that. And I think that's the kind of mayorship that we need.
Sorry, your time is up, Councilmember Gorder. So thank you guys both for your responses. This question was more so to see like how you guys plan on holding PPD accountable. We know that their police oversight has been passed. We've all followed it, but this needs the attention that those communities need are a little bit more intimate than just police oversight. Really quick, just a yes or no question. As mayor, would you host a community meeting within those areas? Gordo?
I have. I've always held community meetings in all of those areas for quite some time, for 20 years. You know, I held one recently, virtually, from Villa Park. A few weeks ago after we had an incident. I have not stopped doing that, and I'm going to continue to do that.
Thank you. Mayor Tornick?
Yes, I've been at Community Arms within the last few months with Pastor Birch. I mean, these are not places that are strange to me. My son lived the answer is yes.
Thank you.
We're freezing up here a little bit.
Yeah. So next question is what you just discussed. So you mentioned the proposal and the oversight commission. So this year we all seen the global reckoning with the death of George Floyd and Breonna Taylor. And many organizations like NAACP and Elon pushed for this commission, the oversight commission, but it wasn't until one of our own, Anthony McClain, was killed, born and raised Pasadena, PUSD, a former PUSD student, not until he was killed did the council push or pass the oversight commission. Why was that? So we'll go first with Mayor Turner.
Well, in fact, the vote was scheduled before the McLean shooting. So that's not an accurate representation. We have been working on it after the George Floyd back in May, the George Floyd killing. We had been hard at work at it for months, and I had committed to bring it to the council within 45 days. And so it is true that the McLean shooting happened just before the vote, but that vote had already been scheduled. John Kennedy and I were already being criticized by Councilmember Gordo and others for moving too fast, for not following the traditional Pasadena format, for moving too aggressively on it. The narrative that he suggested, the history is not accurate. Nobody was shut out of that process. Ask the people in the room there, well, and they're not in the room, but the NAACP, how many conversations I had with NAACP officers and members about this issue, what suggestions I drew from them. Ask the 700 people that submitted their comments online, or the hundreds and hundreds of comments that came into the council meetings. This was not an exclusive backroom process. This was an incredibly participatory process. It's just that it was consolidated into a short period of time because we felt a sense of real urgency and not wanting to shine people on and say, we're gonna go through a process, we'll have a committee, we'll have a blue ribbon panel, we'll have months of meetings. We felt that we needed to take action swiftly. As it happened, the vote was immediately after the McLean shooting, but that vote had already been scheduled as part of an accelerated process that John Kennedy and I were supporting.
So let me say this. You know, you're all young leaders, up and coming young leaders. You're involved in your community, and I thank you for that. I was once in your shoes at a younger age. But let me tell you who is in your shoes right now and is a leader in this city: Vice Mayor Tyrone Hampton. I didn't say originally, you know, I wasn't one. I never said we're moving too fast. What I was reacting to is the vice mayor of this city, Tyrone Hampton, a millennial, young leader who was pressing very hard for oversight when he said to me, and he said to all of you publicly and said to Mayor Tornik, I was not a part of this. Dismissed, outright. That's what I'm talking about. And when you cut out the vice mayor of the city who's pressing for oversight, and you shorten the debate, it also cuts out the community's input. And it wasn't about moving too fast. It was about not being inclusive. What Mayor Tornik's not telling you is they canceled meetings of the Public Safety Committee that could have kept the process moving and could have included the view of the vice mayor and Steve Madison, that could have included all of your voices as this thing, as this model and this subject was being developed. That did not happen. And don't take it from me, take it from half of the committee, Mr. Madison, longest serving member, and Mr. Hampton, the vice mayor of this city, who has been a strong advocate for oversight, but never got to participate. And he will don't ask me, ask him. He told you.
Yeah, something we want to highlight again is that there was a proposal, but many people in the community felt that it wasn't strong enough. There was questions about the subpoena power and about how the commission was going to be appointed. Not after the killing and Anthony McLean, did the council organize to have more power in that commission. Mayor Turnick, would you like to rebuttal?
Yeah, the narrative that's been suggested is completely false. Vice Mayor Hampton was not excluded. In fact, when he said we should take a shot, even though there's not much time, at the charter reform alternative, I scheduled a special meeting of the council and accelerated the discussion so that there would be an opportunity to do that. And the fact that the discussion moved from the Public Safety Committee to the council was with the support of Councilmember Madison, who has now been suggested was cut out. I think it's important to understand it wasn't just about speed. It was about intensity and about trying to be responsive to the community. And that's why we acted with such a sense of urgency.
That's why too, not we.
Member Gordo?
Yeah, let's not recreate history. Let's look at the statements made publicly, passionately, by Vice Mayor Hampton and Mr. Madison. And they will say there was no we, it was two. And just like dismissing our neighbors in the San Gabriel Valley, dismissing two members of a committee who are passionate, who are duly elected members to give their views. And in the process, who else gets cut out? The community. It's not me saying it, they said it. And those of you that followed the issue know that. You heard it from the vice mayor and from Mr. Madison directly. And frankly, some of you probably felt it too.
And as in the chat, there were suggestions that were given, but they weren't used. But we'll move on to the next question. The next question is, have you visited the memorial for Anthony McLean? If not, what has stopped you? As mayor, how will you ensure the community is being served? Councilmember Gordo.
I have gone to La Pinte and gotten out of my car and walked around, absolutely. And how will we support? Again, you know, we need to do things differently. You know, when over a year ago, long before the issue of George Floyd came up, long before we struggled as a country with oversight and trust and how to support our community, I asked Mayor Tornick and the council to let's look at department by department at how we're serving the people of Pasadena, all communities, particularly communities who are at risk. I asked, let's look at, see if the programs are serving people, or are we just doing what we did 20, 30 years ago because it's in place? And Mayor Tornick will tell you that I asked for that. I think 2 years ago, I have demanded that. We haven't done it. I said, let's look at, you know, how we're supporting young people. Let's look at how, you know, the Department of Recreation, the Parks and Public Works and Human Services at the time, let's see how they're coordinating to support our families. And I said, let's do it department by department, not just in the police department. And, you know, it didn't happen. And so that's an issue that we need to look at very closely. So how will we serve these communities in all our communities? By being smarter with the resources that we have, by ensuring that they're actually reaching the people that we're intending to reach.
Thank you, Mayor Tornick.
Yeah, the process of looking at how we spend our money, we have begun a process to make it as transparent as it can be. Part of the problem with people's understanding of how the city functions and how we spend our money is that they look at the general fund budget and they see that the largest expenditure is the police department. And in total, in the general fund, that's true. But when you look at all of the expenditures, while the police department is still the largest, the amount of money that the city spends on human services and non-public safety issues is much larger than most people realize. So I think we do have to do a better job in terms of sharing ideas about how dollars are allocated, how we really spend our money. The process that Councilmember Gordo has referenced was begun and has been continued. It was interrupted by COVID in terms of the departments that didn't have an opportunity to be reviewed. We had scheduled four departments. We only got through the PD. But I think that there needs to be a serious community dialogue in terms of how we do allocate dollars, why we spend money the way we do. And I think people will be surprised when they see how many city resources are spent on non-public safety in terms of what we spend in housing support, in terms of total dollars, not just the general fund, housing support, recreational support, the dollars that we're allocating now to the school district. I mean, the full picture is that Pasadena is really being much more supportive on the human services.
Mayor Turnick, also the question was, have you visited Anthony McLean's memorial?
Oh, if I'm sorry. Why not? I have visited that memorial.
Thank you. Council Member Porter, would you like to rebuttal?
So we only got to the police department because we didn't start when I suggested that we do that. We didn't start, you know, I think it was 2 years, at least a year and a half ago that I asked for that. And I said, look, you know, when it comes time to budgeting, this is what happens in the budget process. Every department shows up and they get, you know, 15, 20 minutes. And in that time, we're expected to quiz them about, you know, more public safety, park safety specialists, as I've done, to engage people in a non-threatening manner, civilians working for the police department. We have, you know, limited time to look at the programs. And so I said, this should be an ongoing discussion to see if we're doing the right thing, to see if our programs are effective. And I'll tell you, waiting until, I think it was January or December, after I made that suggestion long before, was, you know, it just put us right back to the process that we've always done. That's why we only got to one department, because we didn't make it an ongoing discussion where all of you could participate and give us your impact, where the people we're looking to assist could give us their feedback and give us
a chance. Councilmember Gordo, Mayor Turnick, would you like to rebuttal?
Well, I would say that we should have we will revisit the budget process, because we've made a lot of efforts to involve the public with very minimal success. But I will also say that the major focus that my takeaway from Councilmember Gordo's advocacy in the budget was to increase the police department budget and to hire more sworn officers. That was the major takeaway in terms of the real emphasis that he had during most of these budgetary hearings. In retrospect, I think now that has been seen as probably not a good idea.
Thank you. So again, both of you mentioned that you have been to the memorial. There's many people in the chat that have said they have not seen you or when. So that's you know, a thing there. Next question, Nicole.
So in order to make sure some of our community questions are answered, because we have several, these are going to be our last two questions, and then we're going to move on to community questions. The first question, it will go to Tornik first, and then Councilmember Gordo. It is a yes or no question, no explanation, and the question reads, do you support the Black Lives Matter movement and the social justice change they are trying to make in the community? And by that, we mean racial injustice, police brutality, criminal justice reform, economic injustice, environmental justice, access to health care, access to quality education, voting rights, and things of that nature. Yes or no? Go ahead, Mayor Tornik.
Yes.
Thank you. Councilmember Gordo?
Yes, I think we all approve the principles.
Thank you. And the next question, it's only right that we have a question related to millennial leadership, since this was put on by Pasadena Homegrown Leaders. And that question will go to Councilmember Gordo first and then Mayor Tornik. So what are your plans for raising the next generation of leaders? As you guys continue to be in these positions, there's gonna be a need to fill them with the next generation of leaders, whether it be mayor, council member, Senate, and those types of positions. And then this part B to that is, how do you plan to engage millennial organizations such as Hood Liberation, Pasadena Young Leaders, and other organizations in the community? Go ahead, council member Gordo.
So, you know, I think we, you know, the best indication of future conduct is past conduct. And I can tell you, you know, I've been very supportive of young leaders, including our vice mayor, who I have a great deal of respect for. I'm not dismissive of him. I embrace him. I don't always agree with him, and he doesn't always agree with me, but we always communicate. I don't say, yes, 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 you know, we'll talk about that later. I don't say, you know, we've already talked about that and it's been decided. I don't say things like that, and I'm not going to. And so the best indication of how I'm going to support young leaders is how I support our youngest leader on the city council today. Not everyone can say that. So I will work with all of you in the community who want to express and who haven't expressed a willingness to contribute. Because again, I walked in your shoes. I started at day one, wanting to bring people together, to work together. And I remember what it was like to be a youth programs coordinator at day one with people like Tim Rambo, people looking to bring together factions of Bloods with Crips. And it was my job to support them as they did that by ensuring there were activities for them to direct the kids to. That was in 1990, 1992 through 94. And so I know what it's like to be someone who wants to contribute. And I know what it's like to be dismissed and, ignored. And I'm not going to do that. I'm going to continue to do, as my past conduct shows, and as the vice mayor of the city will tell you, to value the opinions of young leaders and to work with young leaders to ensure that they have a voice and that they feel not just listened to, but heard and are a part of the process.
Thank you. Mayor Tornik?
Yes, I have made an active effort to recruit younger people to commissions, to appoint them to boards and commissions. One of them is in attendance here tonight, I see. But I think that it's hard. It's hard to get people to participate in ongoing meetings, to support them and to make sure they feel it's time well spent for them because they've got a lot of things competing for their time. But I've done that. I've continually tried to recruit people so that they can get educated in how city government works and what it really means. Beyond that, I get in the public schools every 2 weeks in normal times, not now. But I go to classrooms every 2 weeks at all levels of the PUSD, in elementary school through high school. And I talk to classes and I talk to students. And one of the things that I urge them to do as part of my pitch is I reference the fact that Pasadena has 1,100 nonprofits, 1,100, and that the nonprofits are a critical part of what makes us an extraordinary city. And I urge them to try to find a nonprofit organization, if not a city commission, that is of interest to them that they can volunteer in, because I think that's a good kind of farm team and introduction for people in terms of giving back to their communities. And I explain to them that they will get more out of out of that experience than they even contribute. And it has a very receptive audience, and Pasadena is blessed because whether you're interested in environmental issues or social justice issues or historic preservation, we've got a commission or a series of nonprofits that works in that area. So I have been very active talking with young people, trying to recruit them and listening to them. I have ongoing Zoom sessions with them, even during this pandemic, to try to encourage them and find out what their difficulties are. And of course, I've got two granddaughters that are both young adults.
Thank you, Mayor Tornik. I'm sorry. Thank you. So similar to you, Gordo, I also started off at day one when I was in high school, and that's how I got a lot of my personal experience learning how to do a lot of the community engagement stuff and even policy. But as a millennial now, with bills and kids and stuff like that, without the proper compensation, majority of us aren't able to participate participate in activities like that. So that's where that question had came from. And I see in the chat here, a lot of my fellow millennials are having the exact same issue. And this can become a barrier as we decide to run for the positions that you, Mayor Tornik, are in, and Councilmember Gordo. So with that being said, we're going to move on to community questions.
If I can rebut.
Go ahead.
Yeah, this notion that, young people are, busy and have their attention everywhere. It's true. That's the same argument that Mayor Tornik's campaign's using against me. Victor's a working dad and I can do it full time. He can't. Well, I've done the job for 20 years. I've been here. And so to hear him now use that same argument, you know, that it's hard for you. Well, you've been doing it too. And I know many of you have been doing it. And you've been doing it because you make the time, as I have, and as I have for 20 years. And it's a false argument to say it's hard for you when you've been doing it. And so I reject that notion that only, you know, someone that's retired has the time to do what we know we've been doing very directly and for a long time. And so I suggest that you reject that argument too. When you have passion and compassion for the people of this city, you and I have made the time and will continue to do that.
Thank you.
I have a comment on that. To suggest that somehow holding, you know, multiple employment opportunities puts Councilmember Gordo in the same category as a working mom or a working dad or a millennial that has demands is to really stretch an argument to almost unrecognizable form. I think the issue is what the demands are of this job, not whether or not Councilmember Gordo is entitled to be a working dad.
I'm sorry, you guys all froze. Tornick, would you, Mayor Tornick, would you mind repeating what you said? I'm sorry.
Nicole, I think everybody else heard it. I think you're just.
Okay. Sorry. So we're gonna go ahead and do community questions at this time. The first question comes from Reggie Miles, and it states that neither of you discuss financial literacy education in Northwest for generations to come. We understand the dynamic of selling and buying. We want to know a vision or at least some time on how to address it. Hearing, we're going to talk about it and affordable housing. Obviously, affordable housing and the perspective of both of you does not combat full gentrification. Do you have a response to that?
I'm sorry, Nicole, you're breaking up. I don't know if Mayor Tornick heard the question either, but it's hard.
I didn't get it.
Hold on. Jose, do you want to read the question then?
Which question?
It's about financial.
It came from Reggie Miles. I'm
trying to find it. As we find that one, what we could do is we have also some other community questions that were submitted. This first question is, we are living through a BLM movement and a pandemic, raging wildfires fueled by climate change. Have these multitudes of crises caused you to reevaluate any of your political positions? If so, what? And we'll go with Councilmember Gordo.
I'm sorry, maybe it's my, Jose, I apologize. Can you just read it one more time, please?
Yes. So we are living through a BLM movement, a pandemic, and raging wildfires fueled by climate change. Have these multitudes of crises caused you to reevaluate any of your political positions? If so, what?
Yeah, of course. I mean, you know, the what we've experienced during the pandemic and the fires and with the issue of trust and transparency has caused a shifting of my thinking. I've been open to being educated. And by the way, on the issue of oversight, I've always said, if we can do things better, then let's do that. Then let's look at it and let's talk about it. And you can't help but be transformed with what we've experienced of late. It absolutely has caused a shift in my thinking, but it's also caused me to believe that we need to do a better job of being prepared. You know, when COVID, for example, struck, you know, many of you saw me jump right in. You know, I was here, I was working, I was speaking of making the time. You know, I went out and met with small business owners, restaurateurs. I wasn't somewhere else. I didn't refuse to participate in meetings I was right here trying to get us moving, demanding that we not cancel meetings. I was saying, you know, let's be more proactive. And that has caused me to change my thinking on the how prepared we are, not just as a city, but as a society. And I think we all need to take stock in what's happened involving the social justice, involving economic disparity, involving the city's ability to respond to crisis. And we should all have changed a bit and be prepared, you know, as young leaders and working leaders to ensure that we're better prepared for the future. That's how it's changed my thinking.
Thank you, Mayor Turnit.
Yeah, the biggest learning experience I've had is that I think that these crises have really shined a bright light on conditions that really we should have known about or we did know about. And that maybe we just didn't focus on enough. So a lot of the issues that we've been grappling with, that we've been struggling with, the food security issues, the homelessness issues, they are issues, the social justice issues that were referenced in terms of the Black Lives Matter movement. These aren't new. I mean, these are existing conditions that we know about and should have known about. But I think what's happened in terms of my thinking is it's intensified my thinking and made me recognize that we can't just conduct business as usual, that we have to be willing to move in a different way on some of these issues and take on responsibilities that before maybe we've avoided. The response to the civilian oversight is one example, but there are other examples. The regulation and supervision of nursing homes is another example. Where the system that was currently in place is obviously inadequate, and that's become a national scandal, and there are all kinds of simultaneous investigations undergoing about that. So I think what these crises have done, climate change is not new to us, wildfires are not new, but all of us understand that we can't just sort of shine them on and not address them. And so the positive things that we already were doing, I think we just have to recognize, and I think young people have always recognized that we have to move faster and more aggressively on some of them.
Yeah. Thank you. The next question from the
You know, it is in a time of crisis where we you know learn about things like leadership. We do the skilled nursing facilities were there. It was Vice Mayor Hampton. And I, who said, you know, we need to move quickly on the skilled nursing facilities. It was Vice Mayor Hampton and I who said, let's at the very first meeting, and Mayor Tornik regrettably did not participate in that meeting on March 17th, where I said, and Vice Mayor Hampton said, let's support the kids in the schools. Let's do something about food. And there was resistance. There was actual resistance to setting aside money we were asking for 500,000. Then we said 250,000. Then, you know, it got pushed down and pushed down. But we came back and we said, no, we need to do more. And you know, that's where we show leadership. When we said, you know, we were experiencing a high level of infection and deaths at Pasadena's nursing homes. Let's recall who was making the argument to be more proactive during that moment in crisis.
Thank you, Councilmember Gordo. Thank you. So now we have the next question.
Nicole? I got a comment on that as well, I think.
Oh yes, go ahead.
Thank you. So I think there's a confusion here about what leadership means. And I think that leadership doesn't mean just raising a series of questions and criticizing the people who are doing the work. Leadership means getting the facts, allowing the people who are responsible to do the work to actually do the work and make sure they have the resources to be able to do it. So I think that it's absolutely true that crises sort of bring out the best and the worst in people. I think in terms of the city staff, the 2,000 people that work for the city of Pasadena, they demonstrated an extraordinary capacity to get emergency work done.
Thank you, Nicole.
So the next question states, where do you stand in regards to the Summer Hill developers wanting to come into the community and build a 4-to-5-story building on the corner of Villa and Las Robles with not a single affordable housing unit on site? Are you for it or against it? Do you plan to protect this culturally rich part of Pasadena from such a building? As mayor, how do you ensure such developers are held accountable when they claim they will bring affordable housing off-site?
I'm sorry, Nicole, I think you froze up again.
Who goes first? I'm sorry, I've lost track.
I'll repeat the question again, and then Councilmember Gordo can go first, followed by Mayor Twink. So the question is, where do you stand in regards to the Summer Hill developers wanting to come into the community and build a 4-to-5-story building on the corner of Villa and Las Robles with not a single affordable housing unit on site? For those of listening, this is where the 99-cent store is. Are you for it or against it? Do you plan to protect the culturally rich part of Pasadena from such a building? As mayor, how do you ensure such developers are held accountable when they claim that they will bring affordable housing offsite?
It's, you know, for those of you that followed that discussion, that's one of the problems in Pasadena is, you know, the scales are tilted to outside developers and at the expense of people who live here. And, you know, it's not just about affordability. It's about services, parking, and at the expense of all neighborhoods. I was offended by that project. You know, twice the density, twice the height, no affordable housing. And I said it very clearly. This is wrong. You know, people in this neighborhood already can't park. And, you know, most of the buildings there are two stories. This is socially wrong. It's economically wrong. And I'm going to hold that developer accountable. And I started to the day the project appeared by saying, no, this is wrong. You cannot do that to this neighborhood, to any neighborhood. Think of, you know, where people already can't park, you know, street cleaning, all of those things. And then no affordable housing. And I was very tough holding that, saying that we should hold this developer accountable. Terry Tornick can tell you what he said. He defended the project and the developer. He may change his view now, but that record is clear. And I'm still upset about that. You know, they said, well, there's one building, you know, not too far from here that's taller, and we should allow that building to guide us. And I think that's wrong to change the fabric of an entire neighborhood with no affordable housing. But that's the path that we're on, where developers have the upper hand over everyday Pasadenans and every Pasadena neighborhood. That's in large part why I'm standing up for Pasadena and all of us, because it's wrong. And I said it when that project came forward, and I'm going to continue to hold these developers accountable to being more respectful of our city. Not just build, you know, multi-million dollar condos. That's the development that a developer wants. It's not the development that someone who grew up in this community and our neighborhoods wants. And that's why I objected. And I'm going to continue to until they get it right. Now Mayor Tornick can tell us what he said.
Mayor Tornick.
So that project came to us for what's called a PPR, preliminary project review, where it's in an early stage of formation and they want to get the council's reading on how we react to it. Council was not voting on that project, but the kinds of conversation that you're hearing tonight are exactly the kinds of demagoguery and fear-mongering around new development that flies in the face of what Pasadena really needs. Pasadena doesn't need vacant lots and abandoned stores. Pasadena needs more housing. And the notion that because the housing isn't being built on site means that it's not meeting its affordability requirement is simply not true. And Councilmember Gordon knows that very well. We've got an ordinance that allows you to either build housing on site, the 20% affordable requirement, or to contribute to a fund so it can be built elsewhere. And we have a number of projects around the city, great projects, that have been funded by the what's called the in-lieu fee that developers pay if they don't build their units on site. I think it is desirable to build the units on site. And we had a loophole in the ordinance where the in-lieu fee was too low. And so developers were using the in-lieu fee as a way of not building the units on site. We've closed that loophole when we increased the percentage of affordability to 20%. So if they don't build the units on site, they will be built elsewhere in the city to do the very thing that Councilmember Gordo was suggesting, and that is spreading affordable housing in various districts of the city. So I think to condemn a project that is going, that's not yet designed in its full measure, hasn't been tested against the parking issues and the other issues that he's raising, to condemn it out of hand and at the same time talk about a housing crisis just doesn't make any sense and doesn't connect the dots for what's really good for the future of Pasadena.
There you go, everyone. It hasn't been tested. It's been tested, Mayor Torning, by the people who live in these neighborhoods. We know, and they've spoken. We know, and they've spoken about the lack of affordability. It's been very tested. You just haven't heard it. You know, we've talked about parking in that neighborhood. We've talked about street cleaning in that neighborhood. We've talked about the need for affordable housing everywhere in the city. We've talked about the impacts of these developments with twice the density and height in this neighborhood too. Just like the people in Southwest Pasadena have talked about it. Just like the people in West Pasadena and East Pasadena have talked about it. And it's been tested there too. You just haven't heard it. And let me tell you something. We're going to work together as a city, as a people, to ensure that not only is it tested, but it's heard and we address it. That's the point. It's absolutely been tested everywhere in every part of our city.
I think that people need to understand, and it's really important that they understand that the regulations that have been developed to control new housing have been as a result of hearing the people, years of conversation, thousands of people to determine what densities are appropriate and where they're appropriate. What Councilmember Gordo was saying is that when someone comes in with a project that conforms to what those voices said and what the plan is for the area, to allow us to construct the kind of housing that millennials are going to be living in, where are you supposed to live? If we're not able to build housing, because what we do is every time a project comes up, if there are some loud voices that are complaining about it and don't want it, we shout it down and we throw out the plan and we decide we're not going to do it, you guys are going to have no place to live. And the city, all this conversation about providing housing for people and trying to improve rent conditions in the city, all go out the window, because then there's no consistency, there's no approach that has the long view for the city in terms of what its future will look like. It just responds to the loudest voices that are raised at the latest possible moment. That's not the way I think we should conduct the way we do business in Pasadena, because it doesn't serve your interests. You're the group that's going to be impacted by that.
You are the voices, and you have spoken about
this. Each of us got a chance. I mean, that's the way it works.
Well, but no, we've gotten.
All right. So I'm going to go ahead, because
the question wasn't answered, Mayor Torning, at all.
So I'm going to go ahead and jump in just out of respect for time for everybody involved. So if you will go ahead and give a 1 minute closing remark, starting with you, Councilmember Gordo, then to Mayor Torning.
Sorry, closing remarks?
Yes, please.
So let me just again thank you for the opportunity. You know, it's a humbling experience. To have the experience that I've had in Pasadena, now stand before you and say I'd like to be mayor, and to have received so much support throughout the city. I hear you. I'm not going to dismiss you. I'm going to embrace everyone in every part of the city, because a lot of these issues have been tested. They just haven't been heard. And let me say, you know, I was honored to come in first place in the primary and have so much support throughout the city, and we're going to build on that. You know, I'm not going to just study issues and then come to you and say, you know, well, and by the way, I do study the issues and I'm always prepared. But I'm also going to take it a step further and really prepare by listening, by being prepared to change my own view at a meeting. I don't come to meetings and say, I've got a determination, then go and try and get votes to push that decision on all of you. I listen intently, and sometimes I try and build consensus, and I'm going to continue to do
thank
that.
Thank you, Councilmember Gordo. Mayor Tornik?
Thank you. This has really been a great forum. The questions that you've asked have not been the typical questions, and that's because you're coming at it from a different perspective, and I really welcome that. I feel it, and I understand it. One of the great things about being mayor in the city like Pasadena is that Pasadena has all the complex issues that face larger cities, very diverse places, complicated places, places where I've lived outside of Pasadena. But the difference is that in Pasadena, individuals can make a difference. The scale of the problems, while they're complicated, you can make an impact. If you all stay at it, individually and collectively, you can make a difference. I feel that way, and that's why it's been such a privilege to be mayor for 5 years. And I hope you'll allow me to continue to work with you to make a difference that will affect your futures.
Thank you. So I want to thank everybody for participating and attending tonight. Thank you guys for your patience and just really allowing us to host this first ever Millennial Mayor Forum. Just for the record, we have approximately 1 month, 7 days, and 4 hours until the next election. And if this forum shows you anything, it shows that you need to go out and vote and that you need to actively be engaged, whether that's running for these positions, working on their campaigns, or showing up to council and making sure that everybody's being held accountable to that they're said. So you guys have the opportunity to hear questions and get answers or not. So I hope that you guys take this mission and go out and do what's best. Also, I would encourage you guys all to reach out to them if your questions are not answered. Let's keep in mind, they are running for mayor, and Millennial 2012, according to the census, we've had the highest voter turnout. So let's not forget that. Also, one last thing, the census has been extended to October 5th. So if you have not filled that out, please do so. So thank you guys. And thank you, Mayor Tornik and Councilmember Gordo.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.